CloudExtend Excel is like a Swiss Army knife for NetSuite. There's so many things to do, we won't be able to cover them all. This is just to help you get started. Now, one thing that's really important is CloudExtend Excel for NetSuite respects all the permissions of the role that you're logging into NetSuite with. If you're unable to change the date or edit a transaction, you won't be able to do that in CloudExtend Excel either. So all NetSuite permissions are respected. Let's take a quick little tour. This hamburger icon here is our menu icon. So if I go ahead and click on that, templates will bring me back to this page, which is fairly empty now because we haven't created any yet, which we'll do in a moment. Next, I can go to save searches. And this is where I can go through to NetSuite and I can find save searches that I want to drop back down into Excel. And next on the menu icon is account settings. And this is where you would go ahead and switch accounts. If you want to switch to another account or change your role, you would do that through here in the account settings. And then the trash is where you may have created some templates and then deleted them. They'll all show up in your trash can. You can check the ones that you want and then you can restore those templates. We also have a help section. And when you click on that help section, it's actually going to open up our help site. And from our help site, we actually have a chat icon in the bottom right. You can click on that chat icon and you can communicate with us. You can actually find support articles, et cetera, as well. And you'll find that same chat icon from the template page here as well. So if you're working in the app and you need to send us a question, you can do that here as well. And once you've got a template on a screen, and again, more on templates in a bit, you'll see these action icons down at the bottom of the template. Clicking on download will bring in all of the data for the record type that you've selected for your template. You'll typically want to use a filter to limit the amount of that data or reference a NetSuite save search, and more on that later. Clicking on update will allow you to push any changes that you've made in Excel back to NetSuite. And clicking on delete, as long as you have the necessary NetSuite permissions, will allow you to delete the data from NetSuite via Excel. And then clicking on refresh will take the internal ID, if you have one populated here, and bring in the most recent data from NetSuite for the record type that the internal ID references. Let's start talking about templates though, because templates are a way to map your data between NetSuite and Excel. You can either create a brand new template, and that's what most pro users will start to do, or you can import a template. So let's go ahead and click on import a template. And we give you a few record types here. Note, this is not every single record type in your NetSuite account. For that, you'd want to create a brand new template. But let's go ahead and we'll search for a sales order template. So I'll go ahead and type sales. And as I'm typing, you can see that the list gets restricted to what I'm typing. I'll go ahead and click on sales order. This is going out to NetSuite and it's fetching all the custom fields and all the fields in my NetSuite account. So here I'll go ahead and click on the sales order template and I'll give it a name. I'll call it sales orders imported. And I'll go ahead and click on save. I'm not going to load it yet. We'll go through loading in a minute. Now, once I've got my template created here, I can hover over it and the pencil icon will appear. So hover over, click the pencil icon, and that puts the template into edit mode. And here you can see all the fields that I've actually loaded into my template. Now I'm actually going to get rid of the amount field, and I'm going to show you how you can add in another field such as rate. So I want to put in the item rate. So when I type in rate, it gives me a list of all the possible fields, and I can see item list is the sub list. So everything that doesn't have a colon in it here are the header level fields. So entity, location, transaction ID, sales rep, etc. So those are all fields at the header level, and everything else here with the colon would be the line level field. So here we've got the item, the quantity, tax code, and the rate. So I can click the trash can. I can also move fields around if I want to. So if I wanted to drag rate there, I'll put quantity back because I happen to like that particular order. One other thing I do want to show you, if you're not sure of a field's name, I'll drag in a copy of a sales order over here. And for example, you see this is called trend date. It's not actually date. And if you click on the field in NetSuite, you'll see the field name that it uses for web services, in this case, trend date. That gives you an idea over here what field name to select. So here I'll go ahead and click on next, and I'll go ahead and click on save. And now I'm going to load the template by clicking on it. It's going to warn me that it's going to clear out the contents of the worksheet, not the entire workbook, just the worksheet. And now you can see that we've brought over these fields in the same order that we had them. So we'll talk about A and B in a second, but starting with column C, we've got entity, location, transaction ID, date, et cetera. And if we look at the row one, we actually hide this in a white font. Here's where you can see these NetSuite field names. Internal ID is going to be populated automatically when you create a new record. It can also be used to pull in an existing record. So to do a quick edit of a transaction, I can just punch in the internal ID and into the internal ID column, come over here and click on refresh, and then refresh one more time, being sure that I'm actually in the relevant row. So this is a really great way if you need to just edit one fairly large NetSuite record. So here I can come in and make a whole bunch of edits if I want to change the quantity to 5. In fact, for simplicity, let's just make it 5 on every single one of these. And now if I want to push those changes back up to NetSuite, I'll just go ahead and click on Insert Update. And you'll see that those changes will be reflected on the sales order in NetSuite. We'll know that it's successful because we'll get a message up here in the top right, letting us know that it was successful, and the internal ID here will also change to the color green. So let's take a look at the sales order. So we had quantities kind of all over the place here. I'll go ahead and refresh the sales order. And now you see we've got a quantity of 5 for each one of those items. So next I'm going to show you what we call our what's a picklist field. So in this case here, I'm looking at a location field. Now this is a drop-down field in NetSuite. And you can see over here, if I click on view location values, it's going to take San Francisco and find all the values that have the word San Francisco in them. If I clear that off, it's actually going to give me a list of all the locations in the account. So that's one way that I can change a location. I can also enter a partial value for a location. So in this case, I typed LOSANG and I hit enter, and it's going to go out to NetSuite. If there's an exact match, it's actually going to populate that. So something else you can do is create a brand new record. So anytime the internal ID is empty, so in this case, I'm just going to go ahead and delete the internal ID, and I'll delete the transaction ID as well. Sorry, date's a little scrambled here, but there's our date. Well, let's just say we want to make this for a different entity. So I can come here and I can look up some other entity other than McKenzie Corporation. So we'll choose Tetton Sports. Okay, so we'll drop that value all the way down and we'll make the location Los Angeles. And now I'll go ahead and click on Insert Update. And you'll see that we create a brand new sales order. The internal ID is returned in green and we get this success message. And if we go back and look at NetSuite and refresh a list of sales orders, we'll see another sales order, the most recent one since he's assorted by internal ID in descending order, will be dated 6/14/2018 right here. It's to Tetton Winter Sports, and there's everything on this particular order. So we've got a quantity of 5 for each one of those items. Let's go ahead and take a look at another way to bring data in. So that was a way to bring in one order or one transaction very quickly and make some changes or create a brand new transaction. So here I'm going to use a data filter. So here I'm going to click Create Data Filter, and I'm going to add a new rule. And I only want to see, in this case, let's say sales orders, where a transaction date is on or after, and we'll say June 1st, 2018. Go ahead and click on Save. And now when I click on Download, the filter will be applied, and we'll only see a list of sales orders that were created on or after June 1st, 2018. So here you can see we have several different sales orders in here. So you can tell by internal ID. So there's 57308, 65810, and also the transactions ID. So we've got two sales orders in here that were created. So now we can change data on both these sales orders and push those changes back up to NetSuite as well. Here I'm going to give you a little tip. You can also always reference internal IDs if you want to. So if I want to change this particular line here and set the item to the Google Chromebook, I can just use the internal ID in this format. So two left brackets, the internal ID, and then two right brackets. Let's just do a quick cross check. Yep, 833. So now when I go ahead and push the update for this line, we should see that this particular item gets changed to the Google Chromebook. I'll go ahead and click on Update. And here you can see this particular sales order was updated successfully. And then if I go ahead and click on Refresh, you'll see that the 833 internal ID will be resolved to the Google Chromebook. And you'll also see that the price changed. There was $300 and some odd before, back to $299. And the reason for that is we're using the base price. So since we haven't dropped in a custom price here, it's going to pick up the base price for the item. So it essentially ignores the rate field unless you have an overriding that base price. So let's go ahead and show you how to do that. It's a little tricky to add. We're going to add in the custom field, the custom rate field right now. So I'm going to come and I'm going to modify my template. And I'm going to drop in the price. So the price is actually the price level that you're going to be using. So I'll drop that in right here in the order that I want. I'll go ahead and click on next, and then I'll click on save. Now I'm going to reload that template. I'm going to bring in the internal ID 57308, just so we can make some changes to that. Go ahead and click on refresh. And let's bring in all the lines for 57308. So here you'll see the price level returned with an internal ID as well as a price level. So we're going to go ahead. We're going to look at all the possible item price levels here. And one of the things you're going to see is that custom is not an option. So NetSuite Web Services does not return custom, which is why we see the price level with the internal ID only of -1. So if we want to ever set a price level to the custom price level, just come in here and make it -1, and then you can change your item rate. So we'll make this one now $100, and we'll go ahead and click on update, and we'll send that change back up to NetSuite, and we'll see that the item rate will change to $100. And we'll also see that the price level changes to custom as from base price as well. So there's the success. Here's the previous price level, a base price of $299. So when we refresh this, we should now see that the price level was set to custom with a rate of $100. I'd be remiss if I didn't go through a journal entry for accountants in this world. This is one of the most popular applications of CloudExtend, Excel for NetSuite. So I've created a journal entry here. These are the fields that I've dropped in. So my header level fields, my line level fields. I'm going to go ahead and click on next and click on save. We'll go ahead and load that journal entry template. You'll see lots of demos on our support site and our YouTube channel about how to create brand new journal entries. For example, you could take a credit card statement, create a brand new journal entry from that credit card statement to account for the transactions. Here, I'm going to show another popular use case. We've got a journal entry here that was created on June 14th, but the memo field is left empty and the department field is left empty. So imagine going through the NetSuite UI for all 60 or 100 lines, whatever number happens to be here. So instead, we're just going to take this journal entry. We're going to grab the internal ID again. So we know that internal ID is 65109. I'll copy that to my clipboard. We'll paste it in, and now we're going to go ahead and we're going to click on refresh, and we'll bring that journal entry right into Excel. We'll make changes here in Excel. So here's that entire journal entry. Let's just expand the date field a little bit. And then we want to drop in the department. So we can come over here. We can see a list of valid department values. And we're just going to say this entire transaction is for sales. And then we're going to just show how we can update the memo fields as well. So we'll go ahead and drop those all the way down. Now we can just click on update. And you'll see here in roughly 30 seconds or so, we've pulled an entire journal entry into Excel, and we've made changes to that journal entry, and we've pushed all those changes back up to NetSuite. So here we are with the success returned in green here, and we can come over here and we can click on refresh, and you'll see here now that the memo field and the department field are completed. Now, if you have a repetitive journal entry, something that you're doing on a consistent basis, and you just need to, say, change some of the amounts, you can delete the internal ID, just like we showed with the sales order. I'll go ahead and delete the transaction ID, and maybe you want to change a date, so we can make the dates here, let's just say 6/30/2018, and we can copy that all the way down, and we're going to get rid of line number. They'll be automatically assigned. And maybe you needed to just go ahead and change a few of the debits and credits. So we'll go ahead and balance these out here. And maybe this was a journal entry for a different department. So let's go ahead. Instead of sales, we're going to assign this to admin, and we'll drop that all the way down. Now, when we go ahead and click on update, this is going to create a brand new journal entry dated June 30th with the same memo fields, but a different department and slightly different amounts. So last, we're going to take a look at bringing in a saved search. I'm going to go ahead and click on save searches. And here I'm going to type in the name of the search type. So this is a transaction-based saved search that I want to look for. So I'll type transaction. And then I know it's a search based on sales order. So I'll come over here and type in sales order. And this is going to give me a list of NetSuite saved searches. So in this case, sales orders from 2016 forward. You can do two things here. You can download as raw data, which I'm going to do now. Or you can drop that data into a template. You saw earlier that I created a sales order template and I used a data filter to bring that data into Excel from NetSuite. Well, I could also use a saved search. So if there was criteria that was somewhat difficult to build that you couldn't do with our data filter, you could create that saved search in NetSuite, then drop it into a template. When you drop it into a template, you can make changes to that data and push it back up to NetSuite. It takes longer for that data to download. So if you're only downloading data for reporting purposes, go ahead and click download as raw data. So that's what I'm going to do here. I'll click download as raw data. So here in just about 10 seconds or so, we had 200 rows delivered. Once I've got my data in here, it's pretty easy to go ahead and create some pivot tables, charts, et cetera. I'll just go ahead and create a quick pivot table here. So I can come over here and drop in, let's just say we want to look at the item name, and then we want to look at amount. And then we also want to do a top 10 filter. So we covered templates, we covered different ways of bringing data into NetSuite, either using the internal ID and clicking refresh, or using a data filter or a saved search. We talked about creating brand new records inside NetSuite, and then updating data from Excel back to NetSuite as well. So this is really just kind of the stepping stones. I do encourage you to take a look at our help site, especially the six steps to getting started that we've created here for you. Well, that's it. Thanks so much for watching. Good luck with your trial. We look forward to seeing you.